Hello, my name's Andy Robertson, and I run the family video game database that offers families a way to search for games based on a whole set of criteria. A part of that is accessibility. So I wanted to talk today a bit about why accessibility is important in the sort of video game space, and also to go on to illustrate how big an area this is and how complex it is trying to help families find games with the right criteria, the right features that can match the requirements that they may have, whether that is about partially sighted, as in low vision, hard of hearing or deaf, motor disability, motor impairment, or maybe particularly cognitive need, or all sorts of things that fit in amongst those different phrases. So we've been working on the database probably for about a year now, and it came off the back of writing this book. So I wrote a book for families called Taming Gaming. At the back of the book were lots of recipes of how to find games that you might like to play with your kids, or maybe you'd like to play them yourself. And there's sorts of games that you might not have heard of. And that was a way that I was trying to open the door to help parents gain more literacy in the video games that their children play, and in what video games are in general, to help them then play that sort of guiding role rather than just policing the games of their children. And that led to me creating this online database, which became quite popular during lockdown and offered ways for parents to discover games that maybe offered calm or maybe helped children connect or maybe helped have an educational benefit beyond that kind of entertainment aspect that we often think about games. And so maybe kids weren't just misbehaving if they're playing lots of games during lockdown. Maybe it was a way that they were actually coping with quite a kind of chaotic world. I think there was a bit of relief as parents kind of understood that there was more going on here than just, you know, kids wanted to play games all the time because they were fun. But part of that was kind of the sentiment of the book was to say, oh, video games are a real key part of childhood and an essential way that kids are kind of making sense of the world. And they're kind of a new media, I wanted to say. I wanted to help parents see them as a new media, perfectly fitted for the kind of the time that we're in. And we saw that very much during sort of various lockdowns and during this period of the pandemic, as video games offered a number of benefits to players beyond just entertainment. But having said that, and having established our games are important, they're an essential part of childhood, I realised that that comes with kind of a responsibility to help people of all abilities and or disabilities or impairments access games, and particularly thinking about parents and advocates and guardians of individuals that may have a disability, helping them find games that they're able to play and enjoy and participate in. Not only so they can have some fun, but actually that these games can be a place where if you've got an impairment or disability, there's a real level playing field. So maybe you're not the fastest runner at school, or maybe you know, you can't run around with the other kids, or whatever the scenario is that you're facing. In a video game, there are loads of ways to mitigate that and to offer, as I said, kind of this level playing field where you can play in a way that maybe is difficult in a physical space or in the playground. And so I realised that there wasn't really one way for parents to go and find information about games and to search based on this specific criteria of what their children might need. And this kind of extended, as you can see, kind of the search that we offered on the database, where a parent could come in and find games that match their family. So they might start with, you know, well, what PEGI rating, what age rating is appropriate for my child, what console do we have, what system do we have in the house, and then things like, oh, loot boxes or in-game purchases, which parents might often think, well, I don't know exactly what loot boxes are, but I don't like the sound of them, so I want to search for games without those. And maybe, oh, I like the idea of playing games together in my family, so I'm going to pick games for four or more people. So you can do your search in the database and you get this long list of games coming back, and you can go to one of those game pages and look at the detailed information that's been written specifically for parents. So there's no jargon and it includes all that key information, whether that is how long a game will take, how many players, what costs are there those hidden costs, those loot boxes again, and of course those age ratings at the bottom. And not only the age ratings, but the examiner's report that lets you kind of see, well, why is this game rated a particular age? And then at the bottom of there are loads of games If your child isn't ready for that game, for instance, maybe you're looking up a game and it's older rated, at the bottom you can see other games that are similar to the one you're looking at and are really good games, but are ordered by age rating, so you can find something that's more appropriate. But if we get back to our search, then I realised that it was really important to offer a way to expand that to help parents of children that had a particular requirement to narrow down that search for games that would be suitable for them. So as you can see, we've got a whole host of accessibility features here. And this really illustrates how big this area was. When I first started trying to put this together, my starting point as a novice, coming in as an outsider really, and learning from the accessibility community in video games, I thought I would be creating, well, here are the settings for someone who's blind, here are the settings for someone who's deaf, here are the settings for someone who's got a motor disability, here are the settings for someone who's got a cognitive need, or whatever the areas were. But I soon realised and was advised that that's not how people work, that when they're not in these little neat pigeonholes. And actually, the better thing to do was to specify and focus on what these games offered in terms of accessibility settings and features. Now, some of that was a specific accessibility feature that you could switch on and off, but equally, a lot of this is about the way the games are designed, inclusive design, you might call it. Now that might start with something as simple as a parent wanting to find games for a very young child who is not yet reading, that don't require them to read, so they don't have to come and ask the parent every so often, or what is this person saying, what's happening in the game. Or equally, it might be a parent who likes the idea of the child doing a lot of reading, and so they can pick games that have extensive reading in them, and there's that kind of educational benefit. But then moving on to maybe someone who is visually impaired and needs particularly large clear text or high contrast text in the game. Or maybe if you're hard of hearing or deaf, you need those clear subtitles so you can understand what's being spoken. And where you've got subtitles, what are they like, or how are they captioned? Do they indicate who's speaking? Do they indicate the tone of who's speaking? And also, how good are they at captioning the other sounds of the game that might be really important to play, those environmental sounds? Or maybe you just opt for a game where all the dialogue is voice acted, so you don't have to do any reading at all. And of course, carrying on around this criteria, we can move into controls. So how many buttons, how many sticks do you need? Can you play with mouse or keyboard? Is there touchscreen or motion? And specifically, if you're limited in that motor ability, then how can you remap controls? This can start with just picking presets from a bunch of settings to actually specifying which button does what in a particular game. And then specific things like being able to remap the game menu button so that you don't have to get somebody in to help you access the escape key, if that's what it is, and you can remap it to a key that you can reach on your keyboard or input device. Or the ability to remap one action to multiple buttons so that you've got more flexibility with how you play the game. And then you can look into things like, well, do I have to hold buttons down, which can be a challenge for some people, or is there repeated pressing, or are there simultaneous buttons? And then onto audio. You know, how can I control the audio to make it clearer? Are there audio cues and visual cues for audio events that are happening in the game? So are those two things complementing each other so that if I can't hear, can I see what's happening in that audio space of the game? Or if I'm partially sighted, are there audio cues that help me understand what's happening visually in the game? So it can kind of work both ways. And you can work your way around this criteria so you can build up a search that matches your family. An interesting example here, you've got low pressure. So if you have a child or you yourself don't like being put on the clock, you don't get on with that kind of high pressured timed gameplay, then if you add that search setting to your criteria, then those games will be filtered out. So you have this really kind of helpful and wide ranging set of accessibility features that illustrates, I think, you know, how complex an area this is, and enables you to make that search so then when you do the search, you are then getting back a tailored list of games, you know, for your particular needs. Then you can go to one of those games specifically in the results. If you whiz down to the accessibility area, you can then see, you know, how those games deliver that. And in this game, Overcooked, which isn't considered really low pressure, but if you play it in the practice mode, it gets rid of the clock. And in the later versions of the game, it has some more assists that can reduce that pressure based on time. And you can dig in further and look at an accessibility report for the game, which gives us space to present all that information. And again, you get a sense of how wide ranging this is and how detailed a look you need to get a really accurate understanding about what that game offers. And this takes us down to the bottom of the page here, where we talk about system-wide accessibility. Now, most video game consoles and, of course, computers offer ways to interact that support things like zooming in or remapping keys. Now, the first thing to say, this isn't the same as a video game offering, for example, key remapping. If you're doing it at system level, that's much more restricted. For a start, you can't see what actions you're mapping to which button. All you're really doing is just swapping the buttons over. And equally, you have to change that mapping each time you change your game. So you've got a lot of work to do. And if you've already got a motor disability and it's tiring to work some of these controls, then that can be quite a barrier. So it's important to understand that the system-wide settings doesn't solve it for a particular scenario. And the best thing to do is to design for inclusivity and offer features that are specific to your game to ensure that the widest set of users can take part. But at system level, you do get into some really nice features. For example, the Xbox Co-Pilot feature, where any game on the Xbox you can control with two controllers like it's one controller. Now, this opens up the door to loads of really nice ways of interacting. For a start, an expert player can have one controller and then a novice player can have another, and can then play again and can contribute. Perhaps one player looks after directions and controls and another player looks after shooting. Or the other way around, you could have a novice player and then an expert parent maybe jumps in and helps them when they get stuck without them having to relinquish that controller. But also there's more flexibility here. For instance, if you have a motor disability, you could use two controllers perhaps, one on the floor so you could press it with your foot in different ways and one maybe under the chin or held in the hand. So by having two controllers, suddenly the door is open to a much wider set of ways to play the games. On top of that, there are specific customizations, and there's a whole plethora of these that enable you to control games in different ways. And that starts with things like the Xbox Adaptive Controller, which opens up all sorts of switches and triggers, SIP controls, a whole range of stuff so that you can play the game in the way that you want. And that makes it really customizable, and you can plug in all sorts of kind of non-standard bits of technology to let you access the controls of any Xbox game. And charities like Special Effect and Able Gamers are really good at supporting individuals, providing advice and guidance, but also providing home visits to set you up and get you started. And many of the times I've seen Special Effect come in, set up something like an eye gaze control, so players can then control the game just by looking around with their eyes. And the detail and the nuance of these controls is improving sort of week on week, year on year. So you can really play these proper console games in the way that you want. And the database and these controls and the kind of support of these charities is focusing on this, I think, comes back to the fact that really these video games are kind of an emerging culture. They're an important part of childhood, and they're a key way that children, that this generation and the generation before it really, are making sense of the world. So it's really important, I think, that we take time to understand what accessibility is in this space, how deep and wide it is, how important it is to get it right, and how information like this can make a real difference. Talking to developers about this and getting them to fill a questionnaire out for the database has had some great benefits. Not only do I get the data to then make the search better on the database, but also they would often come away with an understanding of accessibility that's been deepened by going through this questionnaire and all of these 100 different settings, and will often say, oh, I've discovered these new ways to make my game accessible. I hadn't thought about that. This is an easy change for me. And so I'm going to go away and I'm going to do that in the next update for the game. So I hope that's been helpful in sort of fleshing out, well, what is video game accessibility? Introducing the family video game database tool, whether it's just for parents or with this accessibility search, but really giving you a view of this whole emerging area of making games accessible and enjoyable for everyone.